On October 8th, 2019, the Royal Swedish Academy of Sciences has decided to award the Nobel Prize in Physics for contributions to our understanding of the evolution of the universe and Earth's place in the cosmos, with one half to James Peebles for theoretical discoveries in physical cosmology, and the other half jointly to Michel and Didier Queloz for the discovery of an exoplanet orbiting a solar-type star. This was the announcement of the Nobel Prize in Physics of 2019. In this video, we will explore what kind of theoretical discoveries were made and what an exoplanet orbiting a solar-type star tells us about our universe. Part 1. James Peebles. Since 1916, Albert Einstein's general theory of relativity is the basis for all calculations concerning our universe. But when he solved his own equations, he wasn't so sure whether they were right. His so-called field equations led to the conclusion that our universe is expanding. Since this contradicted the common knowledge at that time, he manually added a constant term to his equations, the famous cosmological constant, which acted as a counterbalance. After solving the new equations, the conclusion was that the universe stood still. Over 10 years later, experimental observations showed that indeed our universe is expanding. So there was no need for his counteracting constant anymore, and it was discarded. Einstein called this his biggest blunder. Little did he know that his constant would return over half a century later. But first, let's talk about dark stuff, dark matter and dark energy. First off, why are they called dark? Well, that's because we cannot see them. The way our vision works is that photons interact with the things around us and they reflect them into our eyes. This makes us see the objects. However, if there is no or almost no interaction with photons, none of them can be reflected into our eyes and therefore we don't see anything. That's the thing with dark matter and dark energy. We know that they are there, but no one has ever seen them. The difference between dark matter and dark energy is one pulls, one pushes. In the 1930s, experiments measured the rotational speed of some faraway galaxies. From this speed, we can calculate the mass of the galaxy, but after adding all the masses of all orbiting objects, the result was too small. The conclusion was that there had to be some additional mass that holds the galaxy together. But for some reason, we cannot see it. That's dark matter. We now estimate that 26% of our universe is dark matter, and in 1982, James Peebles was one of the physicists who proposed a mechanism how we could explain this situation, called cold dark matter. In order to understand dark energy, we have to talk a little about curvature. Einstein's general theory of relativity tells us that mass and energy have an effect on how our space is curved. There are basically three possibilities for this curvature. One is that the universe is flat. This happens when the amount of mass and energy in our universe is just right, at a very precise, so-called critical value. In such a universe, two parallel lines would go on forever without touching. The other option, when we have too much matter and energy, results in a so-called closed universe, where two parallel lines will eventually meet somewhere. An extreme example of this would be the surface of a sphere. Even if you start with two parallel lines somewhere, they will eventually meet at the top of the sphere. The final option, when we have too little mass and energy, is called open universe, where two parallel lines will eventually drift further and further apart. Well, experimental measurements, as well as theoretical considerations, give us a clear answer. The universe is flat. This means that we apparently have just the right amount of matter and energy in our universe. However, when we look at our universe, even if we count the stuff we cannot see, like dark matter, we only reach 31% of this critical value. This means 69% are missing. Here again, James Peebles was one of the leading scientists who proposed a solution in 1984, reintroducing Einstein's cosmological constant, which was now seen as the energy of free space, energy of the vacuum. This, together with ordinary matter and cold dark matter, is enough to support the calculations of a flat universe. However, this was still just a theory on where the missing 69% of our universe were. In 1998, experiments showed that our universe is not only growing, but doing so in an accelerated manner. Calculations showed that ordinary matter was not able to cause this, so something else was responsible for pushing our universe apart. By assuming that dark energy is responsible for the accelerated expansion of our universe, it quickly goes from just a theory to something that could be investigated in experiments. Part 2, Michel Mayor and Didier Queloz. On October 6, 1995, Mayor and Queloz announced that they had found a planet orbiting a star similar to our Sun. 51 Pegasi b orbits its star 51 Pegasi, which is around 50 light years away from us, with an orbital period of about 4 days. This implies that it moves very closely to its star, only around 8 million kilometers, which leads to a surface temperature of more than 1000 degrees Celsius. For comparison, we orbit our Sun at a distance of about 150 million kilometers. The surprise regarding 51 Pegasi b was that it is very large, like Jupiter, which has a volume of around 1300 times the Earth's volume and is 300 times as heavy. According to previous knowledge how solar systems are formed, a planet like Jupiter should form very far away from its orbiting star, and thus take a long time to orbit. For instance, Jupiter takes almost 12 years to orbit our Sun. But 51 Pegasi b, which can be compared to Jupiter, orbits its Sun in just 4 days. This means that the previous knowledge of how solar systems form had to be revised. So how exactly did they find the new planet? Planets don't send out light, so it's almost impossible to see them directly. Therefore, Mayor and Queloz moved to an indirect method, using the Doppler effect. Similar to a car that moves toward you or away from you, produces different sounds, so can the wavelength of light coming from a moving source stretch or compress. But why does the Sun move? If we just consider one star and one planet for simplicity, it's easy to see why the star should not be at a fixed place. Gravity pulls the planet towards the Sun, but also the Sun towards the planet. However, since the star is usually much heavier, the resulting effect is much smaller. Still, the star will also move. The best way to illustrate this situation is using the center of mass frame. If we keep the center of mass, which is not the center of the star, fixed, both the star and the planet move around it. And that's why light coming from this star undergoes the influence of the Doppler effect. 2019, the year of cosmology. First, James Peebles helping us understand that the stuff around us is actually more than we can actually see. And second, Michel Mayor and Didier Queloz turning our previous knowledge about the formation of planetary system on its head. And that's pretty much it for this video. Thanks for watching.